And this morning, Hawaiian officials say they're determined to make sure that the false alarm that sent the entire state into panic never happens again.
Yeah, for 38 minutes yesterday, people feared that there was a missile flying through the air and about to hit Hawaii. And it's because of this alert. Ballistic missile threat inbound to Hawaii. Seek immediate shelter. This is not a drill. Now, this is a warning that was sent to people's phones. They showed up on their TVs. They played on the radio stations across the state.
State officials say all of this panic was caused by someone hitting the wrong button. And a federal investigation is now going to begin to figure out how one incident could cause this many problems.
So CNN's Sarah Seidner is in Hawaii. She's got some more details for us this morning.
Victor and Christy, you know, that emergency alert that said that there was an incoming ballistic missile to Hawaii to seek shelter and that it was not a drill did send out a sense of panic to folks here. People trying to figure out where exactly to go, what exactly to do, knowing that emergency managers have been telling people here in Hawaii that there is only a 20-minute span between the time a missile would be launched from North Korea to the time it would make it here and make impact here in Hawaii. It's a very short time for people to figure out what to do and to take shelter. We also were able to speak with one of the state representatives here who was in tears talking about the fact that he had to explain this to his children and take shelter in his house while he was also trying to get information out to his constituents. And what a difficult, difficult thing it was to have a conversation thinking that this could be their last conversation. And we're seeing that across social media as well. People talking about their last conversations they thought they were having with their family members after they got this message. All in all, though, we have heard from emergency management officials and the governor himself. I spoke to them on the phone. They told me that this was human error. They apologized for it. They said it will not happen again. They are looking at exactly how it happened, but they said what eventually happened and how what they determined is that someone accidentally pressed the wrong button during a shift change. They were testing the system, and they have been testing the system here in Hawaii, but never anything like this. The test is an actual emergency siren, an attack siren that goes off, and they have told the population here what it's all about. But indeed, in this time, it wasn't the attack system that went off. It was a message to television viewers. It was a message through the radio and a text message on the cell phone. As emergency managers try and figure out how to make sure this never happens again, they are apologizing, saying this is human error, but it did create quite a bit of emotion here in Hawaii. Victor, Christy.
Sarah, thank you so much. CNN producer Amanda Golden is with us now. She was in Hawaii yesterday when this happened. Amanda, glad you're okay, but help us understand what it was like there when this alert first went out.
Yeah. Hi. Good morning, guys. Thank you for having me. It was incredibly alarming. I've never experienced anything like it. As you guys mentioned, the alerts went off on everyone's phones. It started coming over the television. We didn't really know what to think of it at first. I didn't think it was a legitimate threat immediately until my sister started screaming and was running through where we were staying. I was vacationing with my family. And immediately I called into CNN and I was monitoring Twitter as actively as I could, trying to understand what was happening, and tweeted out a screenshot of the alert because, as you guys said at the beginning, the text of the alert was so alarming, saying that this is not a drill, to seek immediate shelter. And so just trying to figure out what next steps would be when you don't really know what next steps would be.
So where did you go? Where did the people you were with go?
We stayed where we were. We realized very quickly that there wasn't any basement or any other option of a room without a lot of windows. It's, you know, right near the water, so obviously everything is a little more beach designed. And we were tossing around ideas. Do we get in the car? Do we go anywhere? We really weren't sure. So we just all got together and tried to understand what was happening the best that we could.
Did anybody where you were staying or anybody near where you were, were they able to talk to you and give you any advice, or were they, I'm trying to understand what the mood was like, not just with you and your family, but around you?
Yeah, well, we tried to call. We knew other people staying close to where we were on the Big Island, and all of the lines were dead locally. We couldn't make calls. Internet was slowing down. So we really weren't able to communicate with other people other than in our immediate vicinity. And it was just our family and some friends that were with us. So that was part of the problem, I think, was just not understanding if we were alone in this, in these alerts, other than, you know, what I was picking up on the internet.
Amanda, give us an idea of the conversations after you found out that this was a false alarm, because I'd imagine once everyone takes that first deep exhale, the question is, well, what if this had been real? Where were we supposed to have gone? What were the instructions? There was no guidance.
Right. And that's exactly the point, is I was able to have a bit more understanding that it wasn't a legitimate threat sooner than I can imagine most other people did, because I was able to call in to a major news organization and, you know, probably had a good 15 minutes of scare. But compared to others who didn't hear anything until that second alert went out 38 minutes after the first emergency alert came through the phones. All of our conversations were in the immediate following of what happened was, well, there wasn't really a procedure. There wasn't anything that we could have done. There's no set evacuation plans for the state of Hawaii. There aren't any, you know, shelters for people to go into as part of their set emergency plans for something like this. I spoke to locals afterwards, and they say, you know, they get threats for tsunamis or for hurricanes, and they do drills for those kind of things. But there's nothing set to kind of deal with any kind of threat like this if it were real.
So when you went to the airport, because we understand you're now back from Hawaii, but when you went to the airport, what were the conversations you were having and hearing?
I spoke with a few other people who were just tourists like myself, who seemed shaken and alarmed, but for the most part, all right. Surprisingly, a lot of the locals who I spoke to, or people who worked at the airport or who were around that area, were making light of it. And I think you definitely have to have a sense of humor about this, but it was definitely an interesting vibe.